We welcome you to the evening service of the Boonville Church of Christ. As you can see behind me, we're planning on recognizing memory work after this evening's worship service, and consequently there is no children's Bible hour tonight, so we have all of our wonderful smaller children in the auditorium with us, and so you're welcome to the evening worship service as well. I talked to Brother Billy Martin this afternoon, and he said the special contribution for the building fund this morning was a little over $20,000. And so for those of you that were participating in that, thank you for your generosity. In tonight's worship service, Brother Jeremy Jones will be leading our singing. Brother Ricky Green has the opening prayer. Brother Ashton Farr has the scripture reading. Brother Greg has an Old Testament lesson for us tonight. Bruce White has the announcements, and Cole Swinney the closing prayer. Would you join in now as Brother Jeremy Jones leads us in singing?
First song is going to be 613, Hold to God's Unchanging Hand. Would you stand with me as we sing this? 613. Time is filled with swift. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Trust in Him who will not leave you. Whatsoever years may bring, if by earthly friends forsaken, still more closely to Him cling. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. When your journey is completed, if to God you have been true, fair and bright the home in glory, your enraptured soul will view. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Build your hopes on things eternal. Hold to God's unchanging hand. Be seated, please. Psalm before our prayer will be number 778. Be with me, Lord.
Be with me, Lord. I cannot live without Thee. I dare not try to take one step alone. I cannot bear the loads of life unaided. I need Thy strength to lead myself threat. of trial burst above my head. If flashing seas leap everywhere about me, they cannot harm or make my heart afraid. Be with me, Lord, when loneliness o'ertakes me, when I must weep amid the fires of pain, and when shall come the hour of my departure, for worlds unknown, O Lord, be with me then.
Let us pray.
Pray with me, please. Dear Lord, we'll come and thank you for this beautiful Lord's Day, for the time that you've given us to come out and study a portion of thy word through songs and prayer, and a chance to study thy word with Greg. Dear Lord, we pray that this time comes up acceptable in thy sight. We ask you, Lord, to be with this congregation, to be with the teachers, the deacons, the elders, the ministers. We ask that you help the elders be more aggressive and find ways to improve our number where we can spread the gospel. Dear Lord, we ask you to be with the sick of this number, the bereaved. We ask that you help them in any way that you can. We ask you to be with them in only this congregation but throughout the world. We ask you now to be, Lord, to be with us through the remainder of this service. And we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Next song will be number 479, but if you would, mark number 922, Jesus Paid It All. 922, Jesus Paid It All, and we'll sing 479, Peace, Perfect Peace.
Peace, perfect peace, in this dark world of sin. Holy Temple. Let all the earth keep silent before him. Keep silent, keep silent, keep silent
Book of Habakkuk, chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. The burden which the prophet Habakkuk saw. O Lord, how long shall I cry, and you will not hear? Even cry out to you violence, and you will not save. Why do you show me iniquity and cause me to see trouble? For plundering and violence are before me. There is strife and contention arises. Therefore, the law is powerless, and justice will never goes forth. For the wicked surround the righteous, therefore perverse judgment proceeds.
I want you to think back, if you will, over the last several months at the various things that have been going on in our world. Do you think about some of the headlines that you've seen and different things that have happened, things that we hear about on a regular basis as we think about the world in which we live today? We hear about ISIS, is what's supposed to come up. My clicker's not working. We hear on a regular occasion about ISIS, terrorist attacks in general. We hear and read about cops being murdered for no reason. We read about bombings taking place throughout the world. We read about shootings, school shootings, all kinds of shootings, all kind of violence. We hear about the terrible ways mankind is treating mankind. Seemed there for a while that the next day it was almost out of curiosity that we look and wondered what has happened now. What has happened in our world today? Can it get any worse? Unfathomable things have happened. People walking into buildings, into public places, opening fire. People setting off bombs. People running through crowds with cars. We live in a very terrible place, this world in which we live today. And that's not even taking into account all the immorality we see in the world today. The things that are constantly being shoved down our throat. The disregard for God's word. The disregard for God in general. You know, if we look out our window at the world in which we live today, we see a very bleak place. Very discouraging place. And perhaps it's at those times, if you're like me, that you ask the question, why? Why are all these things happening? Why would someone decide to kill all of those people and then kill themselves? Why would someone commit the terrible acts of crime that they commit today? Why is it that the world is as bad as it is today? Why is it that we have to live and raise children in a time and a place that is so discouraging? Why? It probably won't surprise you to know that we're not the first people that have ever asked that question. Matter of fact, as Ashton read for us from the book of Habakkuk, Habakkuk asked that very question. He too lived in a terrible time, a troublesome time, a very discouraging time, and he asked the question, why? Now Habakkuk isn't one that a lot of us are very familiar. Some of us even have trouble pronouncing the name. I don't know if I pronounce it right, but I love saying it over and over again. I love the story of Habakkuk. Because Habakkuk pours his heart out to God. Habakkuk is honest. He gets down to where the rubber meets the road and he wants to know, God, why? why. Let me remind you a little bit about Habakkuk and who he is and what he was in the story that he has to tell. Habakkuk prophesied in the period of 700 to 600 BC, closer to the 600 point, closer to the second half in that time period, probably from 630, 25 down to 600, something like that. But he prophesied during a very troublesome time in Judah's history. Habakkuk was alive and able to watch the nation of Judah rediscover the law during King Josiah's day, but then forget the will of God and the word of God after Josiah was gone. If you go back a few years, remember that when David was king over Israel, Israel was united and strong. But when David's son Solomon took over, things began to deteriorate and to the point eventually that they were divided into two different kingdoms. The northern kingdom was called Israel, and the southern kingdom was called Judah. Now in 722 BC, the Assyrians basically conquered Israel and took them away captive, leaving only Judah. So Judah is the place, the kingdom where Habakkuk lived and prophesied. Prophesied about the same time as the prophet Jeremiah. And we know from Jeremiah that that things were terrible when we read about some of the things that he had to say. Jerusalem, of course, was in Judea, the nation's capital, supposedly the holy city, but it was in a downward spiral. When you think about the fall of the southern kingdom, remember that they had their neighbors to the north that they'd already seen. The folks there in Judah knew what God had done to Israel. They knew that their neighbors to the north had been taken away captive, yet they still refused to turn to God. It didn't come about all of a sudden. If you go back to the time that all of this happened, about 605 BC was the first time that Nebuchadnezzar attacked Jerusalem and took a handful of people to Babylon. And then about 597, he came back and a greater number of folks were taken captive. And then in 587, he came back again, and in 586, completely destroyed the city of Jerusalem. Well, Habakkuk is prophesying prior to this time. He is trying to get the people to turn back to God so that this wouldn't happen. And of course, we know that he wasn't successful in that. If you think about the southern kingdom, let's go all the way back to good old King Hezekiah. Now, Hezekiah did a lot of good things for the Lord and is known as doing some good things for the Lord. But after he died, his son Manasseh took over. Now, Manasseh was a terrible king. Let's just say it that way. Manasseh, according to 2 Kings 21, did evil in the sight of the Lord. Matter of fact, it said he did more evil than the Amorites who preceded him and has led Judah into sin with his idols. So Manasseh was a terrible king and led the people away from God. Well, when Manasseh's life ended, his son Amon took over the throne. Well, Amon wasn't any better than his father. 2 Chronicles 33 tells us that he reigned in Jerusalem 2 years, and he did evil in the sight of the Lord, just as his father Manasseh had done. Well, Amon was killed by his own people. And his son, Josiah, at only the age of 8 years, began to reign. Now, most of us are familiar with Josiah. We know him as a good king. Josiah was one that tried to turn the people back from idolatry. He was the one that wanted to repair the temple of the Lord. Josiah did a lot to help the people, but it didn't last very long. And understand that Habakkuk would probably have been alive during this time, or at least somewhere close to this time, and knew of these reforms that Josiah had put into place, but yet they didn't last. You would think that with the discovery of the law of God and a revival that took place there under Josiah's reign, that perhaps, just perhaps, the people would stay on track. But after Josiah, Jehoahaz, Josiah's son, reigned. He only reigned for 3 months as king before Pharaoh Necho put him in chains and carried him away. Not a good king. Only there for a few months, but not a good king. Well, you'd think as the people watched their king being carried away in chains, that they would repent, that they would change, that they would do something differently. But that's not the case. Pharaoh Necho made another of Josiah's sons, Jehoiakim, king. And he reigned for 11 years. Jehoiakim didn't follow in the steps of his father, Josiah. God's word is very plain in saying that he was a very wicked king. Well, it's in this fellow's reign named Jehoiakim that most folks believe that Hezekiah was preaching, that Hezekiah was prophesying. So Hezekiah is looking around him, and he's seeing all the different things that are going on. Hezekiah has watched the reforms of Josiah's day. He's seen how it had all been forgotten. His heart was breaking, much like the prophet Jeremiah. The people wouldn't listen. Hezekiah saw what was taking place in his own country. He saw the way that the people were turning their backs on God. He saw the slippery slope that had taken root. He saw what eventually was going to happen. But he wasn't only distressed with what was going on in his own country, but he also knew the rising power of the Chaldeans. We better know them as the Babylonians. He saw the Babylonians rise in power. And in their eyes, the Babylonians were the most godless people on the face of the planet. The Babylonians were known for their cruelty. They were known for their disregard for human life. They were known to be the wickedest of the wicked. Yet Habakkuk was with Judah, and Judah was God's people. Surely God would not wipe them out. Surely he wouldn't bring his own nation to his knees, or so they thought. So we have Habakkuk here being disturbed. He's felt the revival fires that had visited Judah during King Josiah's day, but he's seen that fire go from a roaring blaze to flickering embers. He'd watched the temple slowly become empty, and the hearts of people become full of themselves. Pride, greed, violence, injustice, arrogance, all those things had moved into the city square and began rotting the foundation of that city. So we have a man here in Habakkuk, one that was broken and hurt, very much disturbed about what he saw going on among God's people. He saw how mean people could be. He saw great violence, cruel people with little fear of God and respect for each other. He saw bitterness, conflict, strife all around him, contention, arguing, quarreling, disputing, opposition, fighting within and without. Sound familiar? Sounds an awful lot like America, doesn't it? The prophet had preached until he was hoarse. He'd warned the people until he was worn out. Now the prophet feels he can no longer communicate with the people, and he turns to God with heaviness of heart. And that brings us to Habakkuk chapter 1, where in these four verses, we find that Habakkuk said this, "O Lord, how long shall I cry for help, and you will not hear? Or cry to you violence, and you will not save? Why do you make me see iniquity? And why do you idly look at wrong? Destruction and violence are before me. Strife and contention arise. So the law is paralyzed. Injustice never goes forth. For the wicked surround the righteous. Injustice goes forth perverted." We begin tonight with questions. With questions. We're going to have a question, or questions, answer, and the result. Three major points tonight. The question is, why? Why, God? Why are all these things happening? Why are all these terrible things happening? How long am I going to have to keep crying out to you? You know the violence that is here. You know how your people are acting. God, I've done all I know to do. Why are these terrible things happening? And then read what God says in verses 5 to 11. "Look among the nations and see. Wonder and be astounded. For I am doing a work in your days. For behold, that you would not believe if told. For behold, I am raising up the Chaldeans," the Babylonians, "that bitter and hasty nation who march through the breadth of the earth to seize dwellings not their own. They are dreaded and fearsome. Their justice and dignity go forth from themselves. Their horses are swifter than leopards, more fierce than the evening wolves. Their horsemen press proudly on. Their horsemen come from afar. They fly like an eagle swift to devour. They all come for violence, all their faces forward. They gather captives like sand. At kings they scoff, and at rulers they laugh. They laugh at every fortress. They pile up earth and take it. Then they sweep up like the wind and go on. Guilty men whose own might is their God." God says, wait. Wait, Habakkuk. Wait, I have a plan. I have a plan for the Chaldeans, for the Babylonians. They're going to punish Judah. All this that you're seeing in the land of Judah, all the misdeeds the people are committing, all the ways that they've turned their backs on me and serving idols instead, you just wait, I've got a plan. They're going to get theirs, Habakkuk. They're going to get what they deserve. I'm going to punish them, and I'm going to use the Babylonians to do that. And so Habakkuk responds in verse 12 by saying, "Are you not from everlasting, O Lord my God, my Holy One? We shall not die. O Lord, you have ordained them as a judgment, and you, O Rock, have established them for reproof. You who are of pure eyes to see evil cannot look at wrong. Why do you idly look at traitors and remain silent when the wicked swallows up the man more righteous than he? You make mankind like the fish of the sea, like crawling things that have no ruler. He brings all of them up with a hook. He drags them out with his net. He gathers them in his dragnet. He rejoices and is glad. Therefore he sacrifices to his net and makes offerings to his dragnet. For by them he lives in luxury and his food is rich. Is he then to keep on emptying his net and mercilessly killing nations forever?" Habakkuk says, "Why?" And God says, "You wait. I've got a plan. I've got a plan. I'm going to use the Chaldeans. I'm going to use the Babylonians to punish." And here I can imagine Habakkuk saying, "What? What, God? What do you mean? Sure, you've got to be kidding me, God. What? Why? Why would you do something like that? What do you mean that's your plan? What do you mean you're going to use them to destroy us?" And Habakkuk says, "I know who you are." And if you look there at verse 12, even in all this complaining, he acknowledges who God is and some of the attributes that we have at God. You'll notice there in verse 12, he talks about his everlasting presence. The fact that he knows God is going to be there with him. Also, he talks about his holiness. He knows that he's the Holy One. He talks about him being his rock. That sovereignty, that power, that control, that idea that, "God, I know you're in charge of this." And then he talks about that faithfulness that we can have in putting our trust and confidence in God. God is our rock. You see, these attributes of God, Habakkuk remembered as he's trying to wrestle with all of this and decide what's going on. And they can help us today as we go through our everyday troubles to remember God and who he is. But Habakkuk is really confused now. He's really upset. "What are you doing, God?" He says, "I know who you are. I know your everlasting presence. I know your holiness. I know your sovereignty. I know your faithfulness. Why then? Why then use more wicked to punish less wicked?" What Habakkuk is saying here, and I know the language there, it's written in a different kind of style and sometimes hard to understand, but it boils down to this. Habakkuk says, "God, I know who you are, and what you're saying doesn't make sense. I know I complained about Judah. I know I've complained about how terrible they are and how they've turned their backs on you. But the Babylonians, really? They're worse than we are. Why in the world would you use someone that's more wicked than us to punish us? God, I heard your answer, but I don't like it. I don't like your plan." And so in chapter 2, then, we have the answer. The answer that God gives. And this is a lot of different languages. We're going to kind of go through it very quickly. If you look here at the first 4 or 5 verses, the first couple of verses, Habakkuk says, I'm going to watch. I'm going to go to my watch post. I'm going to wait. I'm going to listen to your answer for my complaint. And then this is what God says. "And the Lord answered me, write the vision, make it plain on tablets, so he may run who reads it. For still the vision awaits its appointed time. It hastens to an end. It will not lie. If it seems slow, wait for it. It will surely come. It will not delay." What he's saying there is, this is what's going to happen. It's coming. It may not come as quickly as you would like, but it's coming. Wait for it. And then he says in verse 4, "Behold, his soul is puffed up. It is not upright within him, but the righteous will live by his faith. Moreover, wine is a traitor, an arrogant man who is never at rest. His greed is wide as Sheol. His death he has never enough. He gathers for himself in all nations and collects as his own all peoples." The answer. The answer, first of all, God says you've got to decide. Habakkuk, you've got a decision to make. Habakkuk, the people of Judah have a decision to make. You have a choice to make. You must decide whether you're going to live by arrogance or live by faith. Notice the two different types of people here that are described in verse number 4. The one group are those that are puffed up, those that are built up, those that are arrogant, those that are prideful, those that trust themselves, those that have no need for God, that trust only in themselves to get through in this world. God says that's one way, but the second way is the righteous that live by faith. Those that are going to remain faithful, even in this calamity that's coming, even in the difficult times that are coming, they remain faithful. Those who are rightly related to God, who live for the desires of God, not their own desires. The righteous trust in God, even though in their minds there's no evidence for God's presence present. They know that God is at work regardless of the circumstances or situations of life. And so God says, Habakkuk, decide. Will you trust in yourself? Will you trust in what you think it should be? Or will you place your faith and confidence in me? Arrogance or faith? And then he says, destroy. Verses 6 and following tell what's going to happen to the Babylonians. Shall not all these take up their taunt against him with scoffing and riddles for him and say, woe to him who heaps up what is not his own for how long and loads himself with pledges? Will not your debtors suddenly arise and those awake who will make you tremble? Then you will be spoiled for them because you have plundered many nations. All the remnant of the people shall plunder you, the blood of man and violence to the earth, to cities who dwell on them. Woe to him who gets evil gain for his house, to set his nest on high, to be safe from the reach of harm. You have devised shame for your house by cutting off many peoples. You forfeited your life. For the stone will cry out from the wall and the beam from the woodwork respond. Woe to him who builds a town with blood and founds a city on iniquity. Behold, it is not far from the Lord of hosts that peoples labor merely for fire and nations weary themselves for nothing. For the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. Woe to him who makes his neighbors drunk. You pour out your wrath and make them drunk in order to gaze at their nakedness. You will have your fill of shame instead of glory. Drink yourself and show your uncircumcision. The cup in the Lord's right hand will come to you, and utter shame will come upon your glory. The violence done to Lebanon will overwhelm you with the destruction of the beasts that terrified them, for the blood of man and violence to the earth, to cities and all who dwell in them. What profit is an idol when its maker has shaped it, a metal image, a teacher of lies? For its maker trusts in his own creation when he makes speechless idols. Woe to him who says to a wooden thing, arise, to a silent stone, arise. Can this teach? Behold, it is overlaid with gold and silver, and there is no breath at all in it. All of that says this. God says, I'm going to take care of the Babylonians. They're going to be destroyed because of their wickedness. Oh yes, I'm going to use them to punish Judah, but you don't worry about them. Habakkuk, they're going to get what's coming to them. Habakkuk, all the evil that they have, even though I'm going to use them to punish Judah, rest assured, in the end, they're going to get theirs. Rest assured, they're going to be punished as well. Destroy. Yes, they're going to be destroyed. It's coming. And then the third thing is deity. Deity. As God talks about the foolishness of idols, what profit is an idol? They overlay it with gold and silver, but there's no breath and all in it. They say to a silent stone, arise. They try to get some life out of these idols. God says, that's foolish. That's foolish. But look at verse 20. But the Lord, God, the God, is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him. Do you think about the fact that that song comes from this verse? That when we sing about the Lord being in his holy temple, it's in the context here of Habakkuk's complaint and God's answer and him saying, look at how foolish these wicked men are for worshiping things other than me, for worshiping lifeless things. And then he says, I'm the real God. I'm the only God. I alone am a God. I have the breath. I have the life. I am real. And because of that, demands worship and reverence. Because God is who God is. let all the earth keep silent before him. Isaiah says in Isaiah 55, 8, 9, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, there are my ways, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." You see, sometimes we don't understand. Sometimes we read about what God is doing, or maybe what He's not doing, and we don't understand. And we have to remind ourselves that God is still God and that we're not. That although I may not completely understand His plan, I may not understand all that's going on, I put my faith and confidence in Him and trust Him because He is God and He alone is God. Well, the result comes in chapter 3. A prayer of Habakkuk the prophet according to Shigonoth. I want you to go with me down through memory lane as Habakkuk remembers all that the Lord has done. He says, "O Lord, I have heard the report of you, and your work, O Lord, do I fear. In the midst of the years, revive it. In the midst of the years, make it known. In wrath, remember mercy. God came from Teman, and the Holy One from Mount Paran. His splendor covered the heavens. The earth was full of His praise. His brightness was like the light. Rays flashed from His head. There He veiled His power. Before Him went pestilence, and plague followed His heels. He stood and measured the earth. He looked and shook the nations. Then the eternal mountains were scattered. The everlasting hills sank low. His were the everlasting ways. I saw the tents of Cushan in affliction. The curtains of the lands of Midian did tremble. Was your wrath against the rivers, O Lord? Was your anger against the rivers, or your indignation against the sea? When you rode on your horses, on your chariot of salvation, you stripped the sheath from your bow, calling for many arrows. You split the earth with rivers. The mountainsides saw you and writhed. The raging waters swept on. The deep gave forth its voice. It lifted its hands on high. The sun and moon stood still in their place at the light of your arrows as they sped. At the flash of your glittering spear, you marched through the earth in fury. You threshed the nations in anger. You went out for the salvation of your people, for the salvation of your anointed. You crushed the head of the house of the wicked, laying him bare from thigh to neck. You pierced with his own arrows the heads of his warriors who came like a whirlwind to scatter me, rejoicing as if to devour the poor in secret. You trampled the sea with your horses, the surging of the mighty waters. I hear, and my body trembles. My lips quiver at the sound. Rottenness enters into my bones. My legs tremble beneath me. Yet I will quietly wait for the day of trouble to come upon people who invade." We don't have time tonight to go into all of the details of these verses. You know, you can find a good commentary if you want to know some more about that. Look up some of these. But basically what Habakkuk says is, "God, I look back at what you have done in the past, and I remember." All those different references down there, there's references to Moses, there's references to the Egyptians, there's references to Joshua, there's references to all those times that God acted in history. All those times that God saved His people. All those times that God said, "This is the way I want it to be." And so Habakkuk remembers the stories that he's been told of how God intervened for all of these people. You see, when we say today that we have faith in God, it's not some kind of philosophical theorems or something like that. We have proof that God works. We see this throughout the Old Testament. We see this through the New Testament, with the greatest example being the Son of God placed on a cross on a hill called Calvary. Think about the stories that you and I can tell as we think back, as we remember all that God has done. Think about all those great victories that we have to put our trust and confidence in Him. That doesn't mean that everything always works out for the good right now. We have folks that constantly gave their lives for the cause of God. But we see God working and God acting. And Habakkuk knows that he may not understand God's ways, but Habakkuk says, "I stand in awe of your need, of your deeds. I stand in awe of what you've done. I look back, God." After God says, "This is what I'm going to do," Habakkuk says, "Okay, I remember. And when I remember, it causes me to tremble. when I remember about how powerful you are, when I remember about all those times that you worked in history, yes, God, I may not understand. I may not understand, but he says this. Verse 17, though the fig tree should not blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, the produce of the olive fail, and the fields yield no food, the flock be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will take joy in the God of my salvation. God, the Lord, is my strength. He makes my feet like the deer's. He makes me tread on my high places. To the choirmaster with stringed instruments. Habakkuk says, I'm going to rejoice. I'm going to rejoice. As he trembles, as he thinks back to all that God has done, he says, I'm going to rejoice. Even though things are not going well, even though the fig tree is not blossoming, there's no fruit on the vines, the produce of the olive fail, the fields yield no food, there's no flocks in the fold, there's no animals in the stalls. Yet he says, I'm going to rejoice. I'm going to rejoice in God that provides my strength and my salvation. What do we do? What do we do when we find ourselves in the world in which we find ourselves today? What do we do when every other news story is about something else terrible that's happened? What do we do when we look around at all the immorality that exists around us? We turn to God. We put our faith and our confidence in God. I can't give you all the answers, nor can you give them to me as to why all that happens. But I trust in someone that can, and someone that will if he chooses to. I trust in someone greater, someone stronger. Habakkuk asks why. Why? God says, live by faith. Habakkuk says, I will remember and rejoice. Someone says, how can we rejoice in times like this? Remember that it isn't that we always have something to rejoice about, but we do have someone in whom we can rejoice. Corrie ten Boom once said, when a train goes through a tunnel and it gets dark, you don't throw away your ticket and jump off. You sit still and you trust the engineer. You see, when it comes to asking the question why, it's really not about the why. It's really about the who. That's what I want us to do. Trust the who. Trust God. When all else seems like it's falling apart, trust God. Habakkuk says, he is my strength. He is my salvation. Tonight as we sing the song of encouragement, may I ask you in whom you place your trust. If it's anything other than God, it's misplaced trust. In a terrible world in which we live, may we put our confidence completely and wholly in God. Tonight, if you've not done that, and we can help you do that, you want to make some changes, we can encourage you, we can pray with you, we want to do that. If you're not a child of God tonight, please make tonight the night that you become one. We've had one precious soul added to the family today already. It'd be wonderful to have many more. If you're here tonight and we can help you in any way, please come as we stand and as we sing together.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it snow. Lord, now indeed I find thy power and thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt. faded all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, I'll lay my trophies down, all down at Jesus' feet. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow.
Be seated, please.
Good evening. I'd like to once again welcome everyone here to the services at the Boonville Church of Christ. If you're visiting with us, we want to let you know that you truly are our honored guest. We invite you to stick around for a few moments after service to give us a chance to meet you and learn a little bit more about you. I know Aaron covered this morning on the announcements for us, and a lot of things were covered then. I just want to point out a few more things in your worship bulletin. Sympathy is extended to Gay Rowland, the death of her father. That funeral was this afternoon. Want to remember the Gay Rowland family. Also want to add to the list the Gene Farr and his family. Please keep them in your prayers. Some updates on some. I would like to tell you personally, I appreciate all the prayers, concerns that have been expressed on behalf of my father. We went over this morning and worshiped with them over in Tuscumbia and got to hear him preach. I told the kids that, you know, we don't know how much longer he'll be able to preach. I was thinking due to his heart and stuff, he may have to retire soon. And he told me emphatically that he was not planning on retiring anytime soon at all. So we may get to hear him a little bit longer. But he's 77, still going at full time, and appreciate his efforts. I know they do over there. Also, an update on my nephew. Cody White's been in our prayer list. He was thought to have had a tumor. He's my brother's youngest child. He's a senior in high school this year, plays football for my brother down at Caledonia. But just about a week ago, he was cleared of everything. They said it was not a tumor. So prayers are wonderful. Again, we appreciate all the prayers that have been uttered on Cody's behalf. One other one I'd like to add, Yancey Wright is a young man in our band up at Hardin County. He and his family members of the church at Adamsville, Tennessee. He's a sophomore. Just found out this past week we were in band camp and he had to be rushed to the hospital one day. Found a cancerous polyp in his groin area. They removed it. They think they've gotten everything, but he is going to have to go ahead and undergo chemo. We'll miss all of our fall marching season this year. So I want to ask on behalf of the Wright family, if you will, to please keep them in your prayers, this young man who's just 15 years old and dealing with cancer. A few other things that just to mention. Again, want to remind everyone to stick around after services this evening for the Memory Awards ceremony. Also, the Visitation Fellowship Luncheon is next Sunday in the Annex. And a special note I want to just make note of, if you know of someone who needs prayers, needs visiting, calls, cards, what have you, please give these names to Dale Kendrick so that the visitation teams can take that on and honor those requests. Also, Wednesday night, we'll have Wiley Dean with us for a singing worship service. Song requests can be taken through tonight. They have to have time to build the PowerPoint. So if you have song requests, please get those into the church office by tonight. Food pantry item for this week is sugar. Also, the pantry and clothes closet will be open on the 11th and 18th of this month at 9 a.m. Lads Leaders Pearls will meet August 21st in the TAC following the evening assembly. Go ahead and put that on your calendar. If you're planning to participate in Pearls this year, you need to sign up in the foyer on the last leaders table in the hall, and be sure and be at that meeting on the 21st. Also, if you plan to participate in Bible Bowl, also sign that list on the table in the hall. And if you ordered a VBS shirt and have not yet paid, these are the non-workers, please get that money to Brother Larry today, if at all possible. And also, the Jacinta Church of Christ will be starting a gospel meeting next Sunday. It'll run through the 10th, that's Wednesday. So I want to ask you to remember that work going on, that meeting, and maybe we can have some folks go out and visit out there. At this time, if there's anyone who was unable to be here this morning and partake of the Lord's Supper, if you'll go to the back this time, go to the small chapel, there'll be someone there to serve you.
Final song tonight before we have a closing prayer, and then also the presentation will be 10,000 Reasons. Would you stand with me and stand for the prayer, then immediately after prayer be seated.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I'll worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I'll worship Your holy name.
Let's raise that up a little bit.
You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship Your holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I'll worship Your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I'll worship Your holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I'll worship Your holy name. I'll worship Your holy name.
please. Dear loving and gracious Heavenly Father, we are so thankful, Lord, for the day that you blessed us with, the opportunity to gather together, to study the portion of your word, and the opportunity, Lord, to worship you, Father. We pray that everything that's been said and done here today is pleasing and acceptable in your sight, Father. We pray, Lord, for those who are hurting, those who have lost loved ones, those who are sick, Father. We pray to bless them and comfort them in a way that only you can, Father. We thank you for our new brother in Christ. We pray that, thanking you for his decision. We pray that we may encourage him and be there for him in any way that we possibly can. We pray, Lord, that as sinners, we pray that you would please forgive us where we fail you. Father, we thank you most of all for your precious Son. In his name we pray. Amen. Brother Buster, if you could please come over. Do I need to give the Lord's Supper people down in here?
There's quite a bit of them coming back right there.
Okay.
Up under my
side. There was, that it wasn't about power. Tonight I will be recognizing the children, nursery through sixth grade, that have participated and or completed the memory work that our elders have chosen. Those that have recited all the assigned memory work will be receiving a trophy, and of those that we have recited partial segments, they will receive a certificate. I do want to take this opportunity to thank everyone that has stayed to encourage these kids. Thank also to the teachers, to the parents, and students for taking the time to learn more about God's Word. We're told in Proverbs 22:6 to train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Obviously, we can never start too early training our children about the Word of God. At this time, if I can get the nursery one, the children on the PowerPoint to come to the front left, obviously the parents will have to help these children. That is Catherine Huddleston, Maley McCoy, Ellie Farr, Nathan Smitherman, and Annalise Sparks. Please come to the front left so you can be recognized. Also, if the nursery two will be going to the back, Brother Guy Gardner is waiting in the back, waiting for you. And also, I forgot Gus. Sorry. He's in here, but I did forget his name on my PowerPoint. So Gus Farr is well in the back. Our children, Catherine Huddleston, Maley McCoy, Ellie Farr, Nathan Smitherman, and Annalise Sparks. That's nursery one. Nursery two can make your way front. As they make their way to the front, the two-year-olds can go back to Brother Guy. Sullivan Long. Connor McGaha. Luke Jones. Gus Farr. Hayes Parson. As the two-year-olds make their way up, the three-year-olds can go back to Brother Guy. These are all trophies. Lydia Dawson. Come on, Lydia. Good job. Ella Pirtle. Lawson Foster. Shannon Jones. And Lottie Gardner. Four-year-olds can go back to Brother Guy now. Certificates are first. I don't have any Eaton or Joseph. Eaton, I get a certificate. Eaton Woodruff, certificate. Come on, Eaton. The rest of these are trophies. Rest of my trophies. Phelan Hodge trophy. Houston Farr trophy. Ada McGaha trophy. Kindergarten can make your way back to Brother Guy. All trophies. All trophies. All trophies. What? They didn't show up. Julia Bear be next one. She'll be next. Thomas Sloan, trophy. Jack Jones, trophy. Macy Floyd, trophy. Emory Magaha Trophy. Daniel Dawson Trophy. First grade can go back to Brother Guy. Now in the kindergarten, certificate, Julia Berry. Colin Farr, trophy. Ross Parson Trophy. Cooper Allen Trophy. Clara Gardner Trophy. Second grade, first grade, looking for a name, Davis Foster, Mia Rosas, trophy. Sarah Kate English Trophy. Avery Stevens Trophy. Third grade can go back to Brother Guy. Second grade. Liam Sappington Trophy. Asher Sappington Trophy. Hannah Pollock Trophy. John Grayson Farr Trophy. Abby Taylor Trophy. Isaac Farr Trophy. Coley Floyd Trophy. Fourth grade can go back to Brother Guy at this time. Third grade. Certificate for Jackson Stewart. Trophy for Anderson Long. Briley McCoy Trophy. Peter Chenault Trophy. And Jayla Hubbard Trophy. Fifth and sixth grade can make their way back to Brother Guy. Fourth grade, all trophies, Benjamin Pollock. Turner Foster. Tristan Farr. Certificates next to fifth and sixth grade, Gibson Foster. And Levi Sweeney. Let's give all these young people a round of applause. Again, thank you for staying. Be sure to congratulate these children. Thank you.